But actually, before I did grad school, I did my undergrad here too. So I was here for a pretty long time. This is a picture of my freshman year here at Cal State Fullerton. This is the library in the back. And we're like painting the murals and stuff at actually one of the resource centers here on campus. It's the Asian Pacific American Resource Center. So you go in, you'll see these murals. Yeah, that's how long I've been here.
Don't tell them the secret.
But to rewind, my journey here at Cal State Fullerton was very interesting. I started at Valencia High School. That's the high school actually down the street. I grew up here in Orange County. And I was actually a very shy person. I was also a person who wasn't really sure about college because I'm like kind of the first one in my family to go to college. So first generation to go to undergrad, definitely first to go to graduate school. So that was an interesting experience for me. But how I got from here to here is that when I graduated high school, I had a lot of doubt with my abilities, my capabilities of actually going to college. I also had, you know, doubts with like even talking or even conversing with people. I was not that popular in high school. So going into college, I was just like, okay, well, this is a new start. I have to deal with like all that high school problems. Don't have to worry about that anymore. First couple weeks into college, they had this like Discover Fest. I'm sure some of you are familiar with it. I signed up for 6 clubs that first semester, narrowed it down, but to like the Vietnamese Student Association. But I signed up for 6 clubs. Biochemistry, really antisocial, trying to, you know, get in touch with my culture because I am Vietnamese, but where I grew up, there weren't that many Vietnamese people, so trying to get in touch with my culture and stuff like that. And that's how my journey started. Throughout my undergrad, I became president of the Vietnamese club, actually, which was really interesting because people actually joked about it. They're like, oh, what if that shy guy in that corner becomes president? And I did. The next year, became president, became involved with different organizations on campus. Later that year, I also participated in the AAPI Journey to Success initiative, which was an initiative that Cal State Fullerton and all the other CSUs actually had, where they go out to underrepresented communities and actually encourage them to go to college, because by that time, I was like, well, this is something that works with me. Worked also on campus for what is now known as DIRC, Diversity Initiatives and Resource Centers, at the Asian Pacific American Resource Center and the African American Resource Center. So those were interesting experiences. And then afterwards, graduated with my degree in biochemistry, attended here again for my graduate degree in business administration, which was a leap per se, but actually not that different.
Vincent, if I may ask, what motivated you to jump from biochem to an MBA?
Okay, well,
how did that happen?
To begin with, I originally started out with the idea of like, well, do I really want to pursue the rest of my career inside a laboratory? Because I was doing research at the time during my undergrad. And I didn't want to do research like inside a laboratory, but I wanted to still work in that field. So I looked at more of the financial area, because my dad's friend actually works in that area. He does finances for one of the biochemical companies in Minnesota, which is where my family's from. So I talked to him about it, and he's like, you know what, I think an MBA is fitting more of what you're looking into, because I don't like to be restricted, and an MBA would allow me to like work in different fields or different industries if I found it more interesting. Because I don't like being pigeonholed. I don't like being said, since you're in this field, you stay in this field, which doesn't really happen. Because right now I'm doing marketing for a logistics and analytics company down in Santa Ana. So completely different, but you know, got where I got to today. It was a journey though. But that's my quick story about like me being through Cal State Fullerton. But today I actually want to talk to you a little bit about etiquette. And I know like the first slide's of business etiquette, but this is more of etiquette in general, because when you network, it doesn't matter what field you're in, you have to be able to network and actually build connections within your field, or else you're gonna have a hard time finding a career in the future.
Oh, so, real quick too, I'm sorry. Can we have everyone introduce themselves real quick to Vincent before
he
goes on with the presentation? So He knows who you are. So maybe your name, your year, what you're studying, and what kind of grad degree do you want to go for? So we'll start off with Isaiah.
Okay. Hi, I'm Isaiah Polito, and I am a kinesiology major going for physical therapy. And so that's the doctorate program. So I'm very close to applying.
Hello, my name is Cynthia. I'm a third year health science major, and I hope to pursue my master's in public health once I'm done.
I'm Idalis. I'm a third year, and I hope to pursue a master's degree for occupational therapy.
My name's Brittany. I'm a third year health science major and a graduate school to be determined.
My name is Pauline. I'm a kines major and going for OT master's.
Hi, my name is Kelly, and I want to be a PT, and this is my third year of health science degree.
Oh, wow, 3rd years. Okay, this helps me out. So you're around the 3rd year period. It's a good time to actually practice your networking capabilities, because when I was in undergrad, my program didn't really have any of that, practicing and networking. So that was like a train wreck for me. I'll tell you a story about that later, but it was a train wreck for me. But this is a perfect opportunity for you to actually practice speaking and also networking at the same time. And this slide is just, you know, the internet definition of what etiquette is. It's a customary code of polite behavior in society, right? It's a little yellow, but... Customary code of being of polite behavior in society or among members of a particular profession or group. Oftentimes, what people do is they tend to confuse etiquette as like a one-shoe-fits-all kind of style.
I think it's just the font that's not that nice. We are yellow.
That's good. I think this one's good right here.
Yeah,
this is good. So it's usually viewed as a, okay, if I follow these instructions, it will work out, but it doesn't really work out that way. The next slide is why. So I talked to you a little bit about the definition, but why is it important to actually practice learning about etiquette in different areas? Well, first, it enhances your career opportunities. Networking is a very big aspect these days when it comes to trying to go out and maybe like go to her educational degree, or even find a better occupation, or finding a different like job. Networking is really important. You know, of course, building a network. Approachability and respect and confidence and expertise are the things that people don't really talk much about. They say, oh, if you network or if you practice your etiquette, you can network better, you can build those bridges, and then you can be more successful in the future. But they don't really talk too much about approachability, respect, confidence, and expertise. So those two aspects are very important, because in this day and age, there's a lot of prejudgment of you as an individual going into a professional field. So I'll talk to you a little bit about my story of how my etiquette practice actually allowed me to go advance further in my actual job. Because before, I was just an intern, and now I actually work in marketing. I specifically spearhead their marketing for the company, too. And that's because on my first week at the job, or the internship at the time, a lot of people made assumptions. They saw me as like, oh, you're a millennial, and they don't like millennials, because to them, millennials are lazy, they don't do anything, they cry a lot and stuff like that. So that was their prejudgment of me going in. Even like on the first day when I went to say hi to everyone, one of the sales reps didn't even look at me. He was like, just keep on talking, you're gonna be gone. That's exactly what he said. That's the mentality sometimes you will face if you go into the working field. And by practicing, like choosing your battles, by practicing etiquette, by being professional in front of just not just like my coworkers, but also my superiors, I slowly was able to integrate myself. And they even changed their views in what it means to be millennial, or what it means to be even a minority, because at the time period, well, a couple months ago, there weren't that many Asians in my department. I think I was the only Asian in the department. So I'd get comments such as like, oh, okay, so are you like a trans exchange student from like what country? What country are you from? I'm like, oh, actually I was born here. I'm like, oh, that's interesting. I never heard of that before. But again, you get a lot of comments like that. But the whole philosophy I was able to tackle it with the etiquette aspect is to not really like jump on them right away, not to like attack them like, no, this is wrong, what you said was wrong, but actually try to have lunch with them and get to know them and have a conversation with them and build that connection to now where they kind of like, I kind of understand exactly what was the issue from what I just told you in the beginning. Even the sales rep, he didn't like me. I don't think, he's still kind of okay with me, but what happens is that when you build that conversation, that dialogue, it's a lot more easier to promote change within your organization. And in this day and age, that's very vital, especially if you go into a field that you're not the majority in. Right.
And
so,
I think, real quick too, what kind of piggybacking off of Vincent, I think it's important for everyone to really pick up on is him sharing his experience about being the only Asian at the time. That's a reality that you may face. Being first gen, pursuing a field in the allied health professions, the Allied Health Academy essentially exists because we need to diversify the field. So the need to diversify the field is indicative that the field probably isn't as diverse as it needs to begin with. So I think that was very important that he brought that up. So it's good to just be cognizant of that, to just be aware that sometimes you may be the only one and you are trailblazing and it comes with pros and cons, right? So thank you.
Yes, you'll be facing, sometimes you'll be facing some resistance, but that's the whole aspect of it, by going through and actually creating that change in that space where like a new person can come in and be a lot more friendly and welcoming, you know? This is how I was able to win the sales rep over, actually. I do marketing. Marketing was fairly new in that actual company. So to everyone there, they see like, oh, look at this young guy. He's coming in. He's going to somehow boost our sales through marketing. Well, we're a business-to-business company, so we don't really deal much with customers. So it's not like, say, like, I don't want to say Del Taco because that was one of our clients. Like Del Taco, where you post stuff online and people will like it or not like it. It's more of, we work with Disney, we work with Del Taco, we work with like Logitech and stuff like that. So the connection with marketing already is pretty tough because people are like, well, it's a sales thing. You just talk to them individually and then you make a sale and that's it. But through marketing, we were able to increase, I can't show you just because of confidentiality, but we were able to, like this time, it's like you cannot say certain things. We were able to boost the amount of traffic we get through our website, which is one of our funnels for leads. So I was able to show them, look, this is the difference between 2015 to 2016. In March, you had this many less people visiting our website compared to last year. So it's been declining like heavily. We started in July, and now we're going up again. And by showing that and showing them that you are an expert or you know what you're saying, they will respect you more. And that's the difficult thing that you have to face when you're like one of the first to go into that field or the first in that particular company, is that they will see you as unable to do your job too and challenge it too. I've been challenged many times in my little cubicle. Challenged many times, and you have to be able to be on top of things. But to showcase this in a way that you're not attacking them is very important, because the moment you attack them is the moment they shut down. A good example is like, say like your parents or your brothers or sisters, when they start yelling at you, do you start paying attention or you kind of just like phase it all out? You don't really listen anymore.
Who phases it all out? I phase it out.
I phase it out. They're like, you need to do this, 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 this. I'm like, okay. Yeah, I'm not really paying attention anymore. So the whole etiquette aspect is really how to translate what you know or like your image to your environment so then they can actually take it in and, you know, treat you with respect, because that's actually one of the more difficult things you have to deal with in the future when you pursue a field that doesn't have, you're not the majority.
Mohammed, do you want to introduce yourself real quick to Vincent? He's our guest speaker. So,
hi, my name is Mohammed. My major is health science. I'm a senior graduating this fall.
Oh, graduating this fall. Congratulations. Mm-hmm. Almost there. Mm-hmm. So we're going to move into question, like one quick question. what percent of jobs in the U.S. are gained through networking? How many think it's A, B, C? It's actually C. But I checked it up again, and it's actually 85% now. So 85% of jobs are gained through networking. So that's you knowing someone that can get you in. And that sounds kind of, at first I was like, like before I started going to business school, at first I was like, I don't like it's who you know and not what you know. But this is the reality in the United States. So that's why it's even more important to know what you know, but also be able to navigate and build those networks so that you can, in the future, get the job you want or get into the program you want, is to build those connections and those bridges. This slide is an activity, activity of which I planned for 10 to 20, but I think I can split you up into two. So this activity is supposed to try to kind of give you an idea of how etiquette works or how culture work plays into etiquette itself. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to split you into...
I'll be her partner, so it's like even. Is that what you wanted to do?
Oh, no, that's the second thing.
Oh.
The first thing was to
split
you.
Oh, yeah.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to split you into groups. I'm thinking a group of two. Groups of two. Actually, can you be one of them?
Yeah. I volunteer myself. I'll play two.
Okay, so you four will be in a group, and then you four will be in a group.
Okay.
So of you four, I need one volunteer in each group. Can't be me.
Cynthia. Okay. Cynthia.
Okay.
You volunteer. Come on, ladies. Pick a volunteer. Perfect.
Okay.
Pauline. So Pauline's going to volunteer for their group, and Cynthia's going to volunteer for this group.
Okay, perfect. All right. So how this activity works is that I will be giving each group like a set of roles that they have to follow. And then I'll be giving the two individuals that volunteered another set of rules to follow. And those two individuals will be going outside to read the instructions. I'll go outside too in a bit to really explain to you exactly what you're doing. But in the two, just...
Don't go too far. This is not a versus thing.
It's more of an experience thing. Okay, so I'm going to give... I'll give you three, if you can get the locals together.
This one is boys versus girls.
I just put it that way. Okay, so the whole point of this activity that they don't know about is that etiquette is really cultural based. It's not like a set in stone thing, like I said in the beginning. So these are actually different types of organizational cultures that exist around the world, or even like across the state. So read those really quickly.
Thank you. It's more talking smack about the supervisor.
So overall, you're both part of a sales branch, both failing, not doing, sales aren't doing so well. So they're sending in them to come in to actually try to fix things. But this is actually how your workplace is currently set up. So you have one, so you're very strict. You don't, and you say yes boss a lot. You don't really give opinions. You don't give any feedback. because that's not how you're taught. Okay, so when they come in and they say like, well, what is it like over here? You just say like, whatever you think it is. Okay, so very straight. You have it easy. All you have to do is say whatever you think it is. Okay. Okay.
Then living a strict life over here. I don't know how the lives of the ladies over there.
Sassy. Okay, this is a, like the opposite that they have a very casual, carefree type of like setup. So casual, actually, that you don't like rules. You don't like it when people put in new policies. You don't like it when there's regulations. When you go to meetings, it's more casual. You come at, say the meeting's at 1, you come at like 1:30. Completely normal where you're at. Okay, so, but you're open to talking, but make sure that you try to meet this goal right here,
mm-hmm.
which I'm not going to say. but okay, but you understand what you're doing, right?
Yeah.
Because they're going to come in, and they're the supervisors, and they're going to try to figure out the situation, but you do not budge from what you want your roles are, okay?
So we get into character, and we stay in character.
You stay in character.
Okay.
I'll be right.
I wonder how they can take it. But no, I hope like you know, as we're doing this activity, just think about it. Think of the relevance and how it's going to play in your field, because you're going to be as you kind of go through your internships, volunteering, eventually your first job, your second job, and you continue on even maybe to eventually if you want to own your own practice or maybe you want to work for another organization. There's going to be a different culture that comes with it, and being able to recognize and identify what is what is going to help you succeed in your career a lot. Because business, like kind of Vincent said, I mean, he pursued an MBA. Not everyone's going to pursue an MBA. We're all here for allied health. But his skill sets or what he learns can be translated across all fields.
Hello.
Oh, hi.
Hi.
How are you guys doing today? So, how is our business
so
going?
Tell me how your experience
is. Michelle.
It's
good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Michelle.
So I noticed that
we're here for
whatever
our
you
sales
want.
Are not
like,
doing
whatever,
that good.
Whatever you need.
Okay.
Do
so
you guys need help with anything? Like how come it's not doing
your experience
as good as I thought?
Your work so far, I've noticed that some of your sales have been going down a little bit. Can you tell me why that is or if something has been going on recently?
I mean,
really
if you have an idea, then we'll go with it.
No.
You,
so are you guys like
said,
motivated?
We're here to support you.
Stressed?
Oh, okay. Well, that's good.
Too much work?
I think, you know, working as a team, I really want to hear your input as
fine.
Regards to what's going on. So then I can get a complete picture, because just based off of what I know, it's incomplete.
Yeah.
So
we're
I
totally
would
fine.
Really like it if, you know, you could provide some details as to
We trust you.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
Is
so
there anything I can help you with to like get you guys to
do your low sales?
Get better
I
at your
want to
at boosting sales
activities to help remotivate
like,
you.
Do you guys need
I guess reestablish
like,
the sales to get them to the point that we
where you guys
want to
like get a
so
team.
What I was thinking
like
is
outside
that
of the office,
have, some sort of
like retreat
bonus for you if you do reach your.
I
date.
Think the way things are going right now,
I guess
is the best.
If you reach your potential sales,
you don't like meetings.
Maybe the supervisor can bring donuts to meetings because it's, I don't know.
Does that motivate you?
Maybe, because it gets really hard to be on time for meetings. Maybe food, if I know.
If I bring food to the meetings?
Maybe, because I know I get hungry.
That
way we can spend less time eating and make it to the meeting on time.
Yeah.
So if I bring food to the meeting, you guys come to the meeting for the food.
Okay.
Mostly.
Well, earlier.
Oh, you come earlier.
Yeah.
Because you guys don't have to buy the food.
Yeah.
In regards
okay.
to what?
Yeah,
ready to follow your orders.
Yeah,
yeah,
we're ready to just follow
like
whatever.
Meetings at like
10 a.m., so that's why I'm usually kind of late because I need to get my food.
No questions?
Okay.
Traffic.
We're good, yeah.
Are you sure?
Traffic?
Yeah.
Well, I can't do anything about traffic.
We'll do what
you
want us to do.
Then you can postpone the meeting. Okay.
To like
okay.
a better time. What if I do it like after lunch? Or before lunch.
You
so like, I would give her lunch and you guys continue. So like, traffic is like you have to come to work on time anyways. Okay. Yes.
Are you telling them to come on time?
Yeah, to the meetings. Because they don't like meetings, so.
okay, you can sit down now.
Yay! That was tough, huh?
Okay, so before anyone says anything, how did you feel your experience?
I felt a little, unsure of what the situation was, just because they couldn't really provide any experience in regards to what they're doing. That was, you know, a little worrisome because I was like, okay, well, how am I going to proceed with providing a solution if I don't understand from their perspective what's going on? But then from there, they just went ahead and accepted what I provided them. So.
Okay. On a scale of 1 to 10, how successful do you think you were?
I would say probably like a 6, just because they did, like, you know, they just flat out said, okay, we'll go ahead and accept your idea or your proposition for this. But then there wasn't really any feedback in regards to them as to if they agree with it or if, you know, they disagree with it. They were just like, okay, we'll do it because you're saying that we'll do it. But it's, you know, there's not really a communication between the two parties involved as to what's going to happen. Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
How did you?
Well, I kind of felt like the same thing. Like, when I asked them how it was, they were like, oh, it's good. Like, from my side, it wasn't going so well, but they were like, oh, it's good. So I was like, okay, maybe we should, you know, like, get together and, like, discuss it. But they don't like meetings. So I was like, okay. So I'll provide, like, lunch or something. So then, yeah, I got lunch, and then somebody didn't like, it was like traffic, but, you know, I can't control traffic, so I was thinking I should have the meeting, like, during lunch, so, like, she's already on time, and then I give the lunch, and we can have the meeting.
So then you have, like, a lunch meeting.
Yeah.
We do have dinner. It's going to be after this presentation. Yeah, stay.
Maybe that's why.
Well, between you two, so, well, actually, I didn't ask you yet. How successful do you feel like you were with negotiating?
Like a four?
Like,
honestly, 4. Well, because, like, they didn't, like, I proposed a meeting. They're like, okay, yeah, we can do it. Like, they weren't like, oh, but they weren't like really negotiable about the meeting. Like, okay, if you ask for a meeting, we'll go to the meeting, but you know, we might be late and stuff because of lunch, but that's pretty much it.
Okay. I'm trying to debate whether or not I should just send 2 more people out because
I think you
should. Oh, actually, I know. Yeah, 2 more people out for the other 2 scenarios, and that should be good instead. Okay? So, can I get 2 new volunteers? And now I'll explain the reason why I'm doing all this, too.
Okay.
So,
okay. Isaiah's getting out. Someone new.
Can I pick them?
Yeah, you can pick them. Share revenge.
Traffic.
So, Kelly and Isaiah.
Okay. Am I running away?
Yeah. Take this with you.
Do we have a different one?
Yeah, a different one.
Oh, okay.
We're not going to play the same role play. They already know the
same. Stand right outside of here. Okay, so now you're in the role. Is that, again, both of your sales branches are failing again.
Oh,
but
no.
The culture is very different. So this one, everyone's in it for themselves. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
It's very kind of cutthroat.
materials and income are a bigger factor here. So that's what you want. You want your raises, you want your bonuses, you want your statuses. Okay? And then you can read the rest.
And then for you, since you were like the really strict one.
You can be first when you're done in the
oh, okay.
Very
that way we're just like
friendly
not
us.
Breaking necks.
Yeah.
Oh,
so we're super friendly.
Friendly,
yeah.
You were like, hint,
and
hint, with the food.
And
I was like, I don't know how we're supposed to do this. Like,
yeah.
I was like,
yay, we want more
healthcare.
More benefits.
Sure
more community service.
You don't say we.
This should be
tonight.
We're all friendly.
And also, try to, like, one up
like
the next person.
You were here.
We don't want any changes because
okay.
We like the environment how we were like.
No wonder.
And then like we come
like,
to
what's
meetings
going on?
Late too. So that's why we were like, oh, but we like coming to meetings late.
Oh, ready. Isaiah, we're so happy
Hi.
To see you.
Hi.
How are you?
How are you? How are you?
I'm
good.
I'm good. How are you?
Oh,
how
are you?
I see
that
our sales are going poorly.
Can you tell me
the reason why?
So far,
it wasn't
very
my fault.
Friendly,
I've been trying my best
expecting.
To do my hardest at this job.
I'm doing my best.
Sales, so I, just wanted to get some
I think I did the most work in this company.
I mean, if you look at the hours, I put in the most overtime hours.
I don't know. We've been working
a
good together, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I haven't taken
yeah,
any
good. No,
vacation.
I'm not saying
at
all that.
And I've been really
job.
Working hard
we
on the project that
you told
me to work on,
so
but no one else
could. Work
well
together, even if
I've been going outside of my responsibilities
so
and taking on more tasks just to
well,
keep you happy.
And also
so
maybe kind of go on, you know, off
hours
and just go hang out.
Oh, yeah.
That.
We really love that.
Yeah.
We really like the family culture
well,
here, right?
Yeah.
We
would
probably have like a family
night.
Bring in
yeah, yeah,
ones.
That'd be really awesome.
I will give you guys the opportunity.
Okay, cool.
But,
good.
Yeah.
So then,
our sales are going to low, and I want more ideas.
Well, benefits, right? We,
yeah.
We talked about the benefits.
So
what do you think?
I want
so
you guys to
that, we would really
be more connected with each other. And so,
increase our benefits in terms
oh,
of
Pauline, I did most
of
the work.
Of
you did
bonuses,
most of the work. I did not do anything.
Stuff.
Why don't you guys
really
put it as a team and share ideas to make our
profit. We are very efficient in
but
our
I
world,
think that
but also we wanted to
if we share the work
explore more on the community
get
service.
As much
yeah.
Recognition.
Because
yeah.
We're all
like
doing it on each other. And you don't, since you're not in the office with us, you don't know who did
so
the most work.
So we need to assist and provide the
so
services.
So I can say that I did the most work for you.
Yeah, we need to, like, it's like
did
a...
You?
Like our family, we need like give back and help out others.
Why are you
putting
yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
Like your guys' input.
Well then,
so,
I'll come to
the
office
for
next week.
Set some priority onto that.
And
first
see
and foremost,
how
before,
go,
and then
and
help your friend. We want to make sure that the relationship is strong, so we gotta really put
mm-hmm.
more emphasis on that. Before
I don't
to,
know. I'm bad.
What was that? There's a little bit of tension between one another, then maybe we can. We have to move that out before being more effective.
Does that mean?
So are you going to give us a vacation?
I think we could work on that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that if you give me a vacation,
everyone's welcome.
I can
yeah. Everyone's
relax
welcome.
My mind and think
yeah.
about project ideas for you.
Like a big family.
Big, yeah. Big family.
I also think there should be more incentives for us to work harder.
Okay.
No! Pauline, you're so good at this. You should be an actress.
Alright, well, we'll start with you. How successful were you?
Well, I was a little surprised at myself, but some of the ideas I kind of put out there, I think they were cool, but I don't know, I feel like I still didn't reach to the actual people and what I was trying to do. So maybe effectiveness, successfulness, I don't know, like 5 to 6. Yeah.
Okay. You feel like you didn't really bridge that gap.
Yeah.
You were kind of the same thing, hoping that it would work, right?
Yeah, yeah. Trying to like gauge and meet and see what they're really he's saying, because he keeps saying one thing, but obviously, like, underlining that.
Okay. What's the one thing that stood out with you with the group specifically?
Well, they were very supportive, kind of almost like the first night, I think, like whatever you say, yeah, that's a good idea. They kept on agreeing, and but kind of still, I don't know, had a different agenda, like you mentioned the community, service farm and help out others and stuff, so.
So in the end, what was your resolution? What was the new policy or idea?
I didn't really fix one, actually. I just kind of said maybe throw out there on icebreakers, bringing in, like, doing like, events.
Yeah. So your idea is that teamwork increases sales?
Yeah, I would say that.
Okay. All right. Okay.
How did you do? Well, we didn't do it right.
Got the actual report to a meeting.
Well, I think I did like a 4 or 3. Do I have 4? Performance. But actually, they really wanted to have a vacation. Like, well, they always like tell me, oh, I don't have recognition because I did most of the work. But I also offer them to like do like a teamwork communication. Share ideas with each other, but they don't want to because they're so selfish. Yeah, but we didn't solve anything.
It's okay. That usually happens. Okay, so the whole point of this exercise really is that those different roles that I gave the groups, those are actually company cultures. Different organizations around the world actually function in that setting. That doesn't make them wrong. Actually, those cultures are actually correct. The problem that most people run into is the individual going into that culture, because they usually come in with like preconceived ideas. And that's where clashing happens. An example is like the first one. You had the one where they were like super strict and they said yes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, in some companies, in some cultures, it's a sign of weakness to ask for it.
Oh.
Or to ask for help.
Mm-hmm.
So if you were to go in real life and you were to go into that meeting and say, like, what's your opinion? Or what do you think? Or any feedback?
Mm-hmm.
They'll see you as, oh, we could totally, like, take advantage of this person because they don't know what they're doing. And also they're taught to just follow directions. It's more of just the work environment, the aspect of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then the one before, you had...
They didn't
want to
do anything.
The layback. Yeah.
Polly was quick.
It's not that they didn't want to do anything. It's just that's how the time frame is set up. The mentality is meetings at 1, show up at 1:30. It's kind of like how it works over there. A good example would be like, I believe there was one of my friends' father. He's an international student. The company works like that. It's all safe. There's nothing written. There's more of like laid back, easy environment. So how you both navigate those is that you need to be able to read that. Okay, this is kind of like the messages they're sending. So I need to readjust myself to fit with that culture. And that's how the idea of like etiquette is fluid. It changes. It depends on where you are, what location you are. Because in one location, saying giving a handshake and saying hi is perfectly fine. Other locations it's not, and when you do that, it's like a bit of an insult to them. It's like this person coming here and telling us how we run things and how we do things.
Could you break down like the strictness and then the kind of laid back, like what
yeah.
countries does it?
That's the next one. I'll break it down.
It's the same thing.
Yeah. And then you had the collective community one, right?
Yeah.
So that one's very like, oh, we like to do things together because they focus on the future generations, they focus on their community. And then for you, you have the cutthroat one, right? The very capitalistic, I do better, I get more money kind of view. And this is really broken down into different aspects. A good example would be like, these are extremes, by the way. They're very extreme. But an example of the strict one, that would be mainly in areas of like Japan, or certain Asian countries are very strict. That's how it usually is. I believe the one that's more of the whole we aspect, those are actually parts of certain parts of like the Middle East. It's like that, very community driven. And then the cutthroat one, it's a bit like here, but you took it to an extreme scale, but here, how it's normally set up. And let's see, those four.
Cutthroat. Laid back. Okay. The laid back one, the showing up
late to meetings. Oh, showing up late to meetings. Yeah. For that one, I can't remember what particular place they based that one on, but it was close to Australia. Somewhere around Australia. It's
not
that.
Oh, you're ready to leave? And Dallas is like, I bought my ticket.
Wait, are you going to Australia?
No.
But now she is.
Yeah.
Apply for jobs.
Yeah.
Show up to meeting 30 minutes late.
Right, look into a master's program out there.
My family members, some of them are actually in Australia. Because I remember something like that happened. I'm like, okay, well, I'll be there at 1 o'clock. I show up at 1 o'clock. Yeah, they said, oh no, you come a little bit later, for sure. But how organizational culture works is that this is Hofstede's cultural dimensional theory. So history is that a lot of different organizations, wherever you are, their culture is broken down to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It was 5, but now it's 6. 6 different aspects. So you have the low power different power distance and the high power distance. High power distance are people who are like, the boss is over there, I'm over here. I remain over here, and I don't talk to the boss unless the boss talks to me. A low power distance culture is more of like, my door is always open. You come to the boss, you don't even see him as a boss, you're kind of like just a supervisor person there to help you out. So between these two, which one do you think the US is part of? Are we a high power distance country or a low power distance country?
Hi.
You sure? Because like every time when I ask for you, what did you do?
Mm-hmm.
You always ask for feedback. A high power distance country does not ask for feedback. They do not ask for advice. It's my way or the highway. The U.S. is actually a little bit on the low, like 40, like a lower scale of the lower power distance,
mm-hmm.
because we are taught that by asking feedback or by gaining like the ideas of others, we can, you know, build up to a better decision. Which is why, like, when I think you said earlier, oh, they didn't accept feedback, and that was really weird, or something like that, right?
Yeah.
Again, it's not them. It's not them. It's you coming in with the mindset of the U.S. going into that country, or going into that culture. So that's the power distance. Collective versus individualistic, kind of self-explanatory, but the individualistic is the me culture. It's not about my family, it's about me. I like to do this because I enjoy it. And the collective, on the family scale, is more like, I do this because it's better income for my family so that they can have a better life. Which one do you think, right? The U.S. We're a very like family-based country.
Individualistic.
We're a bit of an individualistic country in the sense that we kind of like to express ourselves, especially in this generation. He's like, I want to do art because I like art. If I tell my parents I want to do art, they'd be like, then you're gonna on the street. Like, that's their mindset.
Is there a connection between individualistic societies and low power distance? So, like, because I guess we are individualistic, like, we're just focusing on ourselves, but then we also want that feedback from others in order to, I guess, propose a better solution or something like that.
So are you saying, like, is it possible to be collective and low? Is that what
you're saying? Something like that.
Yeah. There's a, depending on the place, there are
mm-hmm.
different levels.
Oh.
You're not all this or all that.
Mm-hmm.
You have a particular scale of where you're at. There's actually, if you go online, they actually have indexes of where your country is ranked
mm-hmm.
in those areas,
mm-hmm.
which I'll show you in a bit.
Okay.
Uncertainty avoidance.
Hmm.
that's something that we're actually kind of getting more used to, is the ability to accept uncertainty, kind of in the name. Example would be like, when I gave you this activity, how comfortable were you when I was like, oh, well, whatever you think. Like, you kind of had to make things up, like the rules weren't all set in stone, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's uncertainty avoidance. Some countries are totally okay with ambiguity. They embrace ambiguity. Other countries, it's more of like, no, it has to say line item A, it's like this, and it will always be like this until it's changed in another meeting like that. That's the uncertainty avoidance index. Where's the US in this one? This one's a hard one, actually.
So do you think the US is, we embrace uncertainty, like as a country, or do you think we like to play by the book?
Maybe it's shifted, huh? Like it's
changed. Shifted to what?
Probably to be more accepting of it. Because things are kind of becoming more relative.
So higher ambiguity is what you're saying. Right.
Right.
Okay. Masculinity and femininity. Okay, so this one's a bit interesting because this one like tripped up the whole class when they're trying to learn it. They're like, I don't understand the difference between this one and that one. When he said masculinity and femininity, Hofstede, he meant that when your masculine cultures are more of like ones that strive for achievement, rewards, like status. You want to be a lawyer because it's, well, like it's a very respected title. And a supposed feminine type of organizational culture is more of like, well, we're doing this because we're like as a community. They view society as good societies as societies that work together as a community, as opposed to masculinity. So it's good societies that are the ones with individuals that are successful. It's that kind of mindset. So, where does the US fall in this particular one? Do we value success, achievements, striving for more, or do we value like helping others?
I think masculinity.
Yeah, we're on that scale right now currently.
Mm-hmm.
Long-term oriented and short-term oriented, those are more of like I don't want to say plan ahead, because it's not so much of planning ahead, but it has to do with the ability to, what's the word for it? I guess like follow directions. That's the best way to describe it, because it's not like long or short, it's like following directions. How willing are you to kind of break the rules, or not follow the rules as often? So societies that are very strict, usually focus on, confusing the two. Long-term is actually time-oriented. So long-term are people who try to focus on the future. I make this company for my family. I do this because 50 years from now, we're going to get a giant tree that makes oranges. We can have it for free. Stuff like that. So that's the long-term oriented. And the short-term oriented are the ones that are like, now. We plan because this makes profit next year. That's the long-term, short-term oriented ones. I confuse this one a lot, but which one do you think the U.S. is part of? Long-term or short-term? Are we long-term oriented, or do we just think about the now?
I think short-term.
Short-term?
Maybe.
Mm-hmm. Okay. See you in a bit. See you in a bit, because I don't remember the numbers, that's why I say that. And indulgence and restraint, this is the new one, because this wasn't here when I was like learning it. It's our ability to put off rewards. So like a culture with restraint, it's like, it's okay, I don't need that bonus, I don't need that vacation. But when I'm sick, I need those weeks off. And then the indulgent one's like, why do I only have 5 vacations a year? Why can't I have more vacations a year? It's funny because someone actually asked me that question 2 days ago. So which one are we? Indulgence or restraint?
Indulgence.
Sorry, that's kind of true. So this is where we are on the scale. We're very low on partisans. We like feedback. We were like 50, but now we're 30. So we're beginning to like more feedback and stuff like that.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Individualism is 91.
Wow.
Yeah.
We're really high on that. We like ourselves a lot. That makes any sense. Masculinity is 62. Uncertainty and avoidance is 46. Okay. And that's primarily because in the higher the uncertainty, the higher it is, the more that you want to avoid uncertainty. So since it's low, it means that we embrace it. It's the wording that confuses people. So if you're high, saying this again, if you're high uncertainty avoidance, that means you really want to avoid uncertainty. And if you're low, that means you like it. So we're a bit low on that scale. Long-term oriented, we're really low on that too. So we like things now, for short-term people. Indulgence are high. No. That's where we sit right now.
So why do you think, how can this relate? Like knowing like the U.S. culture, how can that help benefit you? Cynthia?
I think just definitely taking that into perspective and seeing, I guess, the mind frame of how organizations are going to be like in the future. I think especially like governmental organizations, just
mm-hmm.
because it, you know, it might be based off of this.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting to see, I guess, the different factors that can come to play when you are applying for jobs or when you get accepted into a certain position. Yeah.
Brittany, you're nodding your head. Want to add on to that? Like, what do you think? Why do you think this is important to know?
I think it's really important to know because for me, I feel like it's going to be beneficial later in the long run when you're trying to, like, do more research on your org and how the culture is like and see, could you really imagine, I guess, in a way, if their organization culture is similar to like that, and to see kind of more like, are you more into like this kind of culture? Or because I know not all organizations are like that, so you may want to see if maybe you would be more likely to imagine yourself in this kind of organizational culture or those kind of different type of organization cultures that you can see yourself more into there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of nice to see the comparison and do more research, you know, the cultures like.
Yeah, and like also like, again, these are just averages, but you even if you look at, let's say this is big companies,
mm-hmm.
small companies can be very different, very, very different. Because I work as like a medium-sized company, so it's a little different from here. We are pretty lower on the individualism scale, so we're kind of like the we aspect. We like to work together, unless you're marketing and you're by yourself. Because it's new. Because it's new, you're always like, who's this guy? But again, this is very different, and you're all in health professions, right? So what is, if you think of the chance or the probability of you traveling to a different country to either work there temporarily or actually collaborate with another country, you have to keep these in mind. Because, like, for example, like some people, when they go on business meetings, they go to, like, say, Japan, and they'll, like, learn all of the etiquettes over there. I'm not going to go into Japan with the American, well, it's kind of acceptable now, but with the American idea of this is how you run things.
Mm-hmm. And in here in the Allied Health Academy, too, it's good to kind of be cognizant of this, because if this is mainstream kind of culture at large, how do you wrestle with that as a person of color? You know, with your own values coming from your own background, how do you find that middle ground where you can understand this and you can kind of maybe translate and tweak it to help your communities? Because in a lot of communities of color, it's more collectivist, correct? It's more
mm-hmm.
kind of about family.
Yes.
So being very individualistic, you can almost be outcasted because your family would be like, well, look at you. Like, why are you so, what's the word? Selfish, you know? it's looked at that. So it's really good to be mindful of this and really have that lens to understand that in certain spaces it's going to be different. And so how do you navigate all those spaces?
Yeah, well, it's very important to keep this in mind. That's why, like, when I go visit another country, I'm not going to be, like, just all too selfish. Or, like, them all too, like, too nice. Or they're too... Because a lot of people, when they first go abroad, when they're working abroad, or they're working with others abroad, that's the complaint usually get. It's because there's a clash between something like here. For example, like the power distance. That's a big thing. Like, someone over there, say that person over there is in charge of you, they're going to treat you like they treat others over there. But to you, you're like, man, this guy's mean. I don't like him. He's like, He doesn't take my feedback. He doesn't take my opinions. I don't like him. But then on his side, he's like, man, this is what the people in America are just like. They just like to chit-chat a lot. Dude. Like, just do what I say. Like, that's the idea. That's the problem when you don't take into account organizational culture.
And to add on to this, too, it's even on a micro level. Maybe in a classroom on a project. If you have this lens and you're working in a multicultural group, like your classmates are of different cultures, even on a micro level, you can kind of now understand, like, oh, maybe they value more individualistic in their home, you know, versus collective. Because, you know, when you work in groups, there's people you click with and you work with. Maybe when you break it down, it's a shared cultural view.
Yeah.
Hmm. Interesting, right?
Yeah.
Well, we're going to shift from the organizational culture aspect to, this was supposed to be Alyssa's. Yeah, there was actually supposed to be one of my colleagues who was supposed to be here, but she was sick, so she couldn't go or come. So I'm going to wing it and show you one of my stories instead. So
story time.
So this actually leads up into more of the etiquette of the U.S., so from here on out, I'm going to explain to you like how the U.S. functions in terms of etiquette. Keep in mind that it's the U.S., parts of the U.S., I won't say all of the U.S. either. So the whole first aspect to show you it's different depending on where you are. Second is just to explain to you more how it is over here. So practice. What's good practice? Oh, so around my... Actually, my third year here in college, I was actually working at one of the research centers on campus. And it was actually not Diversity Initiatives Research Center at that time. It was actually a different, there wasn't even an umbrella. There was just, all the centers were functioning on their own capacity. And the supervisor sent me to a networking event for this art gallery. It was for like AAPI networking event. It's mainly a networking event, but it's at an art gallery. The thing I struggled with at the time was that I didn't have practice with etiquette, U.S. etiquette of any sort. I didn't have practice with anything, so I came in like dressed in like a t-shirt and jeans, and everyone else is dressed in the more formal attire, so like I'm out of place. But I remember because I had no experience with networking or any form of etiquette, so I just said, okay, the only lines I have to remember is, hello, my name is Vincent. Third year biochemistry major, and I'm here from the Asian Pacific and the Research Center to support, right? But I drilled it so hard that when I actually went to the event, I was like already thrown off by the dress code. When I went to the event, like this person's like, oh, do you know what the bathroom is? And I just translated as, hello, my name is Vincent Chan, blah, 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 blah. So I gave my intro to like people who weren't even asking for it. And the lesson I learned from there is just to be and not to over-prepare the beginning, prepare the middle too, because even when I did that spiel, when I came to that actual conversation piece, that's the problem I struggled to. Because I was like, okay, I said my name, I said my major, I said where I'm from. I'm just gonna walk away now and have some of the appetizers. When that could have been a great opportunity to network and get to know people. So overall, what I mainly want to say about this particular story is that it's important to practice all aspects, but be prepared. Do research, which I'll talk about research to you later. But do research as to where you're going and what the culture, what the atmosphere is going to be like. So, in terms of etiquette in the U.S., we're going to go over dress codes really briefly, because Alyssa was in charge of that. So, really briefly, dress codes. Introductions, handshakes, body language, and conversation. The conversation piece is the most important, I think, but we'll go through all of them. Dress code. Wait, before I go there, how many of you are really comfortable with dress codes? Yeah. Kind of?
Kind of.
Kind of, yeah. I'm a kind of person, too. I guess I'm going to try this. So, this was an image that Alyssa put up. I'm assuming that she was going to talk about the different types of dress codes. I'm not familiar with women's dress codes, so I don't have.
Maybe
don't.
We can
get
Erin.
Oh, sorry.
Can we have your input real quick? Alyssa, the presenter, she put together women's dress code in a professional formal setting.
But
you've been in many of these settings. If you could just kind of give some insight of why she may have selected these images for dress code.
Sure. We're just really seeing this right now. did you talk about the reasons for the different ones are?
No.
Are you planning to?
I was thinking over each section because usually the events they label casual, smart casual. Usually in the workplace we tend to go with the business casual or the business aspect, and the business formal is usually for meetings. But that's how we do. That's how our workplace is like, but it's different depending on the location.
Yeah. So, as Vincent explained, like the event that you're going to is going to determine what kind of outfit would be appropriate, right? So generally here, we don't really ask you to dress up too often because we know you're students. But let's say that you're preparing for a job interview or something. I would probably recommend going business formal. But again, it kind of depends on the work setting that you are trying to apply for. Like if it's a nonprofit, sometimes they may not be as dressed up and you may be overdressing, but sometimes it's better to be safe than sorry. So for business formal, typically that would be a pantsuit or a dress, pantsuit or a suit jacket with a skirt. You can kind of get away with, like, depending on what pieces you have, you may be able to get away with, like, using two different separates between, like, the pants being slightly different than the top, but probably recommend getting them together. Business or business casual, that's usually, like, what I wear here, if you've noticed. Yeah, so usually, I guess that's not the case today, but usually like at the knee or lower, a little higher than that is kind of less professional. And frequently pants, blouses, so as you can see, like nobody has, no one's showing their shoulders, right? So it's usually best to be kind of conservative with that, with business casual, like wearing cardigans or a sweater or something. Again, it depends on what your situation is. Like if it's a summer day and you're outside for a business picnic, then you might, you know, be able to get away with something else, but I would always recommend bringing a jacket just in case. Smart casual, I think this is kind of more for, depending on the type of mixer event you might have, if the setting is like maybe bowling, you wouldn't want to show up wearing a dress, right, or a skirt. So again, usually some of the events will indicate what level of dressy they would want you to be, and then casual, I think that's kind of self-explanatory. But again, you notice like she's not like wearing workout clothes or something like that. But you'll notice that a lot of our professors wear workout clothes because we're in health professions and kinesiology, right? So sometimes you can gauge it from what your professors are wearing in class when they go to, maybe they have a business meeting beforehand. I know you'll notice like Dr. Barr, she'll wear a variety of different clothes, but when she has like a meeting with the union or something, then she'll dress up. Other thing to notice are the different shoes to wear. I'm actually kind of surprised that business formal, it looks like she's wearing stilettos. I would probably not wear that, one from comfort, and two, it doesn't really convey the most professional image. I wear a lot of flats just because we're on a college campus and you have to walk back and forth. So keep that in mind, like depending on where you're at, if it's at a conference and you're walking around a lot, like maybe not wearing those heels. Or if you are like some other folks that I knew, when I used to work downtown, they would wear tennis shoes to commute to work, and then once they got to their office, they would switch them out and wear heels. That's an option. Let me see.
Their hair?
Hair, yeah. So, again, like,
sure, yeah.
I think as long as you kind of look presentable, like, I don't think there's necessarily an expectation, like, oh, you always have to have your hair curled or whatever, but I would say, like, each company has their policies. I know there are some places where they don't allow open-toed shoes. Sometimes that's a work issue. Sometimes it's just a work culture. I know at Okafica, the executive director likes to wear her Crocs, but they actually got after her to, like, stop wearing that so frequently.
It goes by tying it back. It definitely ties into culture.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's going to be kind of like what Vincent shared. You're going to be gauging it and seeing what kind of culture it is and how you're dressing. Or always kind of look at workers. Look at
mm-hmm.
how the workers are dressed. Perfect example of business casual and business for women is think of Dr. Espinoza.
Mm-hmm.
She's always dressed up. Like, she looks nice. She's very business casual, business, you know,
yeah.
business.
Mm-hmm.
So she's a perfect example. Dr. Nguyen, too. She's dressed up as well. Dr. Chanchasiri definitely falls in for that realm. So you can just imagine her. She'd be like a really perfect, relevant example of that.
Yeah. And I'm pretty sure that it's either the Career Center or the Women's Center that has business professional clothes available if you don't have any.
I think that was the
Women's Center.
Yeah.
The Women's Center, I believe, they get donations from folks who have professional clothes that maybe they don't fit anymore, or, like, out of style, but maybe not, like, too, not from, like, 20 years ago.
Shoulder pads?
You might be able to pull that off. I know that was, like, one of the challenges for me when I was a sophomore in college and I was doing my first internship at a consulting firm, and I was like, I don't have any clothes. So you may have to see what options you have to maybe borrow from some friends or maybe go shopping at a place like Target or
H&M is pretty.
H&M
is pretty. Forever 21 has some pieces too.
Yeah, I remember I went with my friend to Forever 21 when I was just getting started, and we went on this whole, like, shopping spree. But I would probably focus more on H&M. So.
And with this, when you're building your wardrobe too, you don't always have to go and buy a bunch of things. You start off with basics. Maybe a basic black blazer, one skirt, pants for men, certain dress shirts, a polo, and then you slowly add on to it. Things that maybe initially stay away from the crazy prints and kind of just build with basics so you can mix and match certain things. Yeah, and reuse items.
Yeah, definitely. I would say that, especially after, like, being in the working world for, like, a decade or whatever, some prints you're just...
A decade!
Yeah. There are some prints that you just get kind of tired of, but then, like, with some basic solids and whatever, it's easier to maybe mix them up with something. So, like, you'll notice that I wear a lot of scarves. I'm not a big jewelry person. Like, my ears aren't pierced, and I just grew up, like, not wearing a lot of jewelry. So the way that I accessorize and, like, change things up is with a scarf. So that's something else to consider. But again, if it's July and you have an outside meeting, like, maybe think of something else, but there are different ways to kind of...
And you're going to fit it to your personality.
Yeah.
Like,
mm-hmm.
like what Erin said, the scarf is her accent piece. If you look at Dr. Espinoza, I always compliment her because she has prints and colors and patterns
mm-hmm.
and all that. So you can really mix and match your personality. Even for guys, we can mix and match with our shirts and how we present ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Actually, 1% at my workplace, because the rule is it has to be either business formal. Fridays is casual Friday,
mm-hmm.
so... business casual.
Yeah.
And the
yeah.
reason was because for us is that we get tours. We have a lot of people from
mm-hmm.
facilities, so when we come by, we have to look, you know, neat and nice.
And I know that was something that, like, where I previously worked, people were really excited once we got casual Fridays because that meant we could wear jeans, but we still couldn't wear, like, casual shoes. We would still have to wear,
mm-hmm.
you know, heels or, you know, some kind of formal footwear. So
yeah.
you need to kind of gauge what's appropriate. And what was interesting...
Hi.
Oh, yay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hey. So So what was interesting was, like, at the place where I worked, the San Jose office was able to wear jeans on Fridays, but the LA office could not, even though it's the same company. So
that is true.
Different things to consider.
Yeah, like, even for me, like, we have multiple buildings around Southern California. Irvine is our corporate. They're always business. Santa Ana is our facility locations. They're a bit more lenient, so that's why we get the business casual Fridays and stuff like that. And then our Pullman building, it's all casual. Like, no one dresses up. We're all the same company, so when we have our company get-together, it's really awkward because you see, like, all the dress codes. So yes, Alyssa did this. Thank you again.
Thank you, Aaron, for bringing this.
Yes, this is the dress code usually for women, and then for men.
Oh.
I already said more.
John, come look at this.
That's the cutoff. The jeans.
The jeans. The jeans.
Not the jeans. More casual.
So I would say for men, you know, we're a little bit more limited. I personally feel women have more options.
Yes.
But with men, we're limited, but we can do nice things with the limits that we have. Business casual, if you kind of see me most of the time, you made a comment yesterday, because yesterday I wore a t-shirt, and he was like, you're really casual today. For me, when business casual, I like to go with a polo, personally. It's anything that's collared, right? Keep it automatically presents kind of like, you're here, you're ready. What would you say business and business formal for, like, interview?
Usually interviews, meetings with the CEOs or with the board, it's usually business formal.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have to go tie every time? Cause, like, say,
oh, no.
But, like, for the DPT, if I get into a school that has to do interviews, you know, it's...
Usually what I do is the safe route is that you go formal and then just lose articles.
Yeah, so kind of going off what he said too, it's always better for everyone to be a little bit overdressed because you can take it off, right? If you went to an event and you had a blazer on and you have a blouse and a skirt and you're formal and then you see that everyone's a little bit, like, less formal, take off your blazer, right? Or for guys, you can come with a suit, and GQ would be a really good resource. You can look at GQ. They have a lot of, like, kind of to-dress guides. For women, I know y'all have a plethora of magazines that you could potentially look at that could help you, these, like, how-to guides.
Pinterest.
Yeah.
Or Pinterest.
Mm-hmm.
Pinterest is a
free.
Really good, Pinterest is a really good place. But you would really gauge it by the setting. You know, like, DPT for an interview. Maybe go in a suit and tie, but you look at the other people and you see that they're not as... dressed up or X, Y, and Z, like, you gauge it then. But sometimes that can work in your favor.
Sure.
You being the one that's dressed up.
And, you don't want to be like me at that one banquet where I was, like, wearing that t-shirt.
I think it was Coco Chanel that said it's always better to take things off.
Yeah.
Like, to take things off than have to put things on. Because you can remove it and then you're still fine, right? So I would say always think of that perspective. Obviously, like, you don't have to go all full fleshed out, you know, but... but it's better to be prepared because then you can just take things off.
I mean, like, even for my job, when I first started, I had the tie, I had a matching suit. Well, today I'm wearing a white shirt, but it's not always a white shirt. Always, like, the white shirt, matching suit, tie. Even had, like, a tie clip. Tie clips are nice, too, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Tie clips. Even, like, matching belts to shoes, like, those rules of, like, the...
Oh, yes.
Match the shoes and stuff.
Your belt should always match your shoe color.
Yeah, I don't know.
And it goes for you.
Yeah.
Your belt should always match. For women, it's a little bit different, but generally, like, if you're wearing, like, pants, your belt should match your shoe color.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And be careful with the color black, too, I found. Because when people wear black, sometimes people take it as, like, oh, who died? Usually
yeah.
It's, like, a funeral color.
Mm-hmm.
So especially for the guys, because I know, try to aim for gray, brown, navy blue if you really like corporate formal, but try to avoid black, and that's one thing I had to learn the hard way. Because even my boss is just like, why are you in black?
H&M is a great starting point.
Everyone else is in gray. Like,
they have the whole dressing up section or the dressy section.
Yeah, and the price is not too bad because I think Express, that's like
higher. But once you start making that money, you can start getting the nice things, right? You can start adding all the nice pieces. And I think a rule of dressing too is that you don't always have to have everything expensive or brand name. You can have one piece that maybe you invested in and you can pair it with other things and you can make the whole outfit look expensive. And it's also confidence.
Yeah.
You don't want to let the clothes wear you. You want to wear the clothes, right? It's the way you, because you could see someone wearing all designer, but if they have low self-esteem, you notice it, right? Versus someone who maybe who isn't wearing all designer, but they're very confident in the way they stand and they talk.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it makes them look more, I guess, professional or expensive.
Yeah.
And another thing to keep in mind with all those blogs and tutorials about what to wear, make sure that it's representative of you and it fits. Because sometimes, like, my friend, he just, like, follows the line, okay, I have to have a suit, I have to have a tie, and he comes on the day of, and it's really moving. So he looks like he was sinking into his suit itself. So make sure that whatever you wear, you are confident that this looks good.
And it represents you. So you're going to just kind of adapt it to your style. And like Aaron said, Pinterest. Download Pinterest. If you don't already have it, I'm sure there's a lot of boards out there where you can look up business casual inspiration.
So now the dress code section is over. We're going to talk about handshakes. And I didn't give you all a handshake yet. It's going to tie in with an activity, but how confident are you all with your handshakes? By any chance? Good? Bad enough?
People say I shake weird.
No,
let's try that. You gotta test it out.
Because people say I hold their hand awkwardly. I don't know. They say it's weird that I hold their hand. They say I should shake, not hold.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
I learned that you shake,
squeeze mainly with.
Oh yeah. Okay. So. Yeah. Donald Trump actually does that a little bit like that. So if you see how he shakes hands, it's not a good way of doing it. Actually, hi.
That's Donald Trump, right?
Yeah.
I just knew. I knew. Don't do that. Don't fool them.
Don't fool them.
You might fall over yourself.
But just to go over it again, we're going to do a little bit of that activity later if we have time. Know when it's appropriate. That's the difficult part. Because when I first started, I was like, shake his hand, do I not shake his hand? Do I stand up? Usually, how the U.S. is that it's the person with the higher authority who engages in the handshake. I'm not sure if many people follow that as much anymore, but usually that's the trend. It's usually like if it was like, say I was sitting right here and the CEO comes in, of course I'd stand up. But I don't initiate, he initiates. Because they'll be offered a high for me to do that.
And one thing, a little tidbit to throw into that I learned that I didn't know before, is that if you're saying hi to someone, and let's say they're sitting down and you're standing up, you might want to kneel to get to their eye level. Because
to
kind of get to their eye level. Or if you, like he said, if you're sitting down and someone's standing up, you want to stand up and to kind of, just a little tidbit. You always want to be on matching eye level.
Because it's really awkward sometimes, because you feel, sometimes you get that vibe of a power difference, where you're like, I'm seeing over you, kind of a vibe. So it's good to always be even, in that sense.
Yeah.
So just keep that in mind, whatever position you're in, even if it's like, at a, you know, you go to a birthday party or something like that, you're meeting people, you want to be up with them, and kind of get through the awkwardness.
Yeah.
Eye contact is a very important thing, because I've had people like, really awkward when you do that, because I'm like, well. But again, that's a crucial thing, because in some places, eye contact is not good. That's one thing I actually had to learn, because when my family taught me, you don't look into people's eyes. But when I grew up, I was like, okay, I have to start looking into people's eyes, because they're going to take it seriously, they don't. A polite greeting is nice. It's awkward to just not say anything and shake your hand. 2 to 5 seconds. No, 5 is when it gets a little awkward. 2 to 5 seconds, no more than 3 shakes. You don't want to do 1. 1, 2, 3, 4. I was like,
2.5. I'm out.
And the left hand rule. usually with the left hand rules, I know not everyone's like right hand dominant, but it's expected that you use your right hand to shake hands.
Who's left handed in here? Aww.
Yeah.
I should have
said sorry. But yeah, the left hand rule is important. Unless you're like moving stuff, that's a different situation. But you know, make sure you shake with your right hand. And this is the important one: avoid the dead fish and the bone crusher. It's like, you know, when you shake the person's hand and like they have
no. Oh no, dead fish!
This is dead fish. You don't want to be that person, because then it makes you awkward and it makes them awkward because they're like, I'm grabbing. So you want to have a firm grip. This is weird.
My hands are sweaty.
Oh, here's a trick to shake your hands. Before you shake the hands,
you
just like do this really quick.
That's
so, okay, I'll show you.
That was a good shake. That's a good shake.
Yeah, you don't want to have like the whole like deadness, because that makes it weird.
That was a good shake, Pauline.
Yeah.
She's like, yeah, I got this.
You don't. Also, there's a stigmatism in the workplace, and sometimes you might face this. Is for women specifically, is that sometimes men kind of perceive you as like weak, so they'll be like this or something like that, and that kind of shows that they don't really respect you on that level. So be on the lookout for that sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So a good example would be like if I was to shake your hand, I was had that mindset. Something you should want to avoid is want to do like, hi, nice to meet you, like this. For a business setting, that's not appropriate. Okay,
that's good to know.
You always want to be like, no, I'm.
And you know, ladies, you give them the firm, confident handshake, and you show them what's up.
Yeah, that's how you do. You just like when you do that, you just like sweep it and just grab it.
Grab it. Like, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet
a
you.
Scoop of equality.
And make sure you avoid doing that too. Like for guys specifically.
Yeah,
avoid doing that because that's disrespectful. Because some, like my friend did that one time and I was like, why are you doing that? My other friend didn't like that either. But that's about handshakes specifically. So.
And bone crusher? So. Don't like.
Oh yeah, don't like strength. Like break their arm.
You ripped their arm.
Yeah, because teaching one of my friends how to shake hands, they did that. They, like, first they were like the dead fish. I was like, oh, a little bit firmer, and they broke my arms. So try to practice those. It's a good thing to keep in mind. Body language is something really important. I had images, but my voice is not here. Posture, stomach in, chest out, you know, the usual, shoulders back, head up, eye contact, and a friendly smile. We're here. Sometimes friendly smiles don't fly in certain places. I know. Sometimes they don't fly in certain places. And also break some habits. Don't point. How many of you point at things? It's over there.
Not as much, but it's still
habits
to come out.
Yeah.
I sometimes they're like, yeah, go.
Yeah. That's awful because one time someone pointed with a middle finger. That's like, oh, that's so yes, so make sure you don't point. Don't fold your arms as much because that makes you look a bit closed offish and nervous. Hands in pockets, that's a habit we do sometimes. I'm talking about like in a like a formal networking event. I'm not saying like when you're at your desk by yourself, you can fold your arms as much as you want. Jiggling knee, that's more of a pet peeve that people have. You don't want to do that in a meeting. And also, hiding behind objects. People don't know that they hide behind objects, but they do. Like when I'm talking to like a coworker, a new person, she's like this is hiding. You don't want to do that, because it makes you look like you're not. You're just kind of scared. So you don't want to hide behind objects when you talk to. So when you're at the networking events, usually it's better to have it like at your side.
Mm.
Okay.
Also, one thing I've learned in undergrad that always stuck with me is that when you're at a networking event and let's say there's like food and drink available,
mm-hmm.
it's hard for me because, you know, for us right-handed people, we like to hold things in our right hand. Always hold your food and drink in your left hand just in case you meet someone. You can be like, oh, hi, nice to meet you. Like, kind of like that.
Yeah.
Right? So if you have a drink, if it's an event where there's a drink or there's a plate, keep your right hand available.
You don't want to be that person who's like,
Yeah, or when you're going to an interview. I mean, of course, there's situations where you're holding a lot of things, but generally, if you can, like Vincent said, hold your portfolio at your side or your folder at your side so you can easily shake the person's hand.
And it makes you look more open and willing to talk, because once you have it constructed, like, it's really small. These things are very small, and you're like, I don't think people will put that together, but they do. Sometimes they just, like, one look, and they kind of like, okay, so this is closed off, and it's very subtle. They might not even think that. They might have just not even talked to you.
And the interesting thing with this is that what we learned, because we had to take a health administration class, and we had the COO, so the chief operating officer of Orange County Healthcare Agency, Dr. Donna Fleming, come in, and she talked about all these different aspects. It really roots back to evolutionary biology. It's like how you perceive someone to be open and safe if they're a threat, you know, if they're warm, if, you know, you should invite them in or interact with them. So if you're kind of a bioscience person, that's a kind of interesting thing that's rooted in that. And just kind of like Vincent said, some people think, well, people don't notice stuff, but think about it from your perspective. You notice these things when people do, these little things, right? So kind of flip it, and just when you're in a setting like that, just be aware that people are going to be aware of you.
Distance. This is, I put that in caps, because that's very important. Distance is a cultural thing. Some cultures, they like it when you talk like really close. You like personal space here. Sometimes people aren't that aware of that. Because one time I had this person like right up in my face.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And you know how when someone's like right up in your face, you tend to like...
slow motion?
They're invading their personal space. So when you're networking or when you're meeting new people, make sure you accommodate for distance. But also make sure, again, with all this stuff, make sure you know where you're at. Because I believe in certain countries, it's like it's acceptable that you talk this close.
Or even, like, different settings, because, you know, different people are, like, Vincent, to reiterate, it's like, if you're in a setting where the main culture, the primary culture, everyone's very warm and hugging, you'll pick up onto that. You'll see people hugging and the kiss on the cheeks, versus where it's just very kind of more cold and formal. You just read the situation. Because if you see everyone getting, like, hugging each other, and then they come up to you and you shake hands, that might be a little bit weird, right? So you just kind of have to adapt.
Actually, when you said that, it reminded me of that one. This one time when I went over to a networking event. This one of the Mahalo colleges set up this networking event. I think it was in Hong Kong, actually. Yeah, it was in Hong Kong. And everyone's like hugging. And then I like, hi, nice to meet you. And they just looked at me like,
what am I doing?
They're like, leaning for the hug instead. Because I guess with that particular group, hugging is more acceptable. And that's not even a cultural thing. That was just within that particular group.
And so it's also interacting with people on a micro level, because it's more macro, right?
Mm-hmm.
Bringing it down to like an interpersonal. When you're interacting with different people of different ethnic backgrounds, there's different kind of... these things are different, right? Because culturally they're different. Perfect example, one of the former MPH interns, Ulani, she is Hawaiian. And in that culture, it's very warm, it's very welcoming. And so when I went out to a kind of a after-hours dinner with all staff when I first got hired, she came, and I read on that she started hugging everyone. And so I was like, okay, maybe I'm going to hug her too. When she came to me, she was like, oh, hi, and she was really warm. So you just read it like that, versus other people who are like, oh, hi, nice to meet you. So you're going to adjust accordingly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's important to kind of like read into your environment and make those decisions, because sometimes they're like, yeah, this is acceptable, like, in general, in the U.S., but you won't, in big companies specifically, but you won't always be in that setting. It'll be different every time.
Or when you're, like, in the field, different settings that you're navigating with, working at a school, your own private practice, a hospital, a nonprofit, a private company, an internship, you're going to have to really gauge how that is and adapt, which you will totally be able to do, but it's just having that awareness.
That's body language. And the second last slide is holding a conversation. And I think they can probably eat after this one.
Yeah.
Holding a conversation.
There's food.
Yeah, this
There's food.
It's like, I need to wait a long time. Holding a conversation. So this part is the thing that people sometimes have a difficulty doing. I have a hard time doing this too. Because when at a networking event, I rehearsed my elevator pitch. I know my handshake. I don't know where to go from there. And this part is essential if you want to build those connections when you network.
Mm-hmm.
And actually,
thank
just
you.
Fuck your polite. The first one is research. This one's kind of like a given. Make sure you know who you're talking to. Usually when you go to a networking event, they would have a list of people who will be there. So make sure you know, like, oh, I need to talk to this person because they're in charge of, like, this hospital. I really want to get to know them and see how they practice. That's specific. You want to research exactly who is in that crowd that you're talking to. Questions is a really good way if you don't know. And it's okay to ask questions. You don't want to be that person who tries to act like they know it all and then a false flat on their face. So by asking questions, you appear more engaged with the person you're trying to meet, with the person you're trying to network with. And this one is the one that people tend to struggle with a lot too, is when they overdo it and they dominate that conversation. Because when you network, you want to get to know them, you want to build that relationship, but you don't want to bombard them with everything. And then they're like, well, how did that happen? So make sure you do not dominate that conversation. And be okay with confrontation. This is the one I had to learn how to deal with, is confrontation. This stems back with the whole, well, since I was like the first in my company to do marketing, minority in that company too, I had to deal with a lot of confrontation in the very beginning of the meeting. So you need to be able to gently disagree when you need to. You don't want to be like, yeah, I'm totally cool with that. An example would be like on my second week, I met up at corporate and they had, okay, every month for one day, they have a fun day. It's a fun day. Some days it's like Valentine's Day pass. So it's Valentine's Day / Single Awareness Day, fun day. So the company got to bring in desserts. It's a lot of fun and stuff like that. Around last year in March, they had a fiesta day. And corporate thought it was appropriate to dress, like for some people to dress up as like gangsters and pick them up and stuff like that. And I remembered on that second week when I met them, and they're like, yeah, this is what our department did. They showed the pictures. Like, you should totally like come with us next time fiesta day comes around. We should totally just do it. You should join us because marketing doesn't really have that many people. So they were trying to like lure me into that. So in that situation, it's okay to be like, have a gentle confrontation by saying, I'm comfortable with doing that specifically. Usually when you say that, they get very defensive and automatically they think, oh, you're like one of those people who don't like that. This is not like what they said. This is one of those people that don't like when we do fun things like that. And when you have your meeting with them for the first time, and you have to do that gentle conversation, a gentle confrontation. It's okay to say, because usually when you first meet a person, they're always like, oh, you have to agree. Yeah, they have to like me, so I have to say yes to everything they say. But it's also good to politely decline and say like, well, I don't feel comfortable with it, but if you want to know more about it, why don't we have some lunch? I'll take you out to lunch. Mm-hmm. Talk a little bit more about it. And that's what I did. Because I said, hey, do you want some food? Because,
or coffee or something like
yeah,
that, right? Like, let's get Starbucks,
yeah.
Let's get a snack, or come with me, I'm going to go, you know, I'm going to the student center.
Yeah. So then, like, I bought a whole box of pizza, because that was important to me. Whole box of pizza for that one, like, small department. We had lunch together. And then I got to know them, they got to know me, and then they got to know more of my personal story. And this is really good for you to voice your stories during those times, because that's when they really get to know you. And they actually understood exactly why I felt uncomfortable when they did that, which is why they don't do that anymore. They're like, okay, well, I can kind of get it now. Because in the beginning, if I did a harsh confrontation where like, no, this was wrong, shame on you, stuff like that, they will shut down completely. So that's one thing I had to learn is, you know, that gentle, like.
And this is kind of, I think Vincent hits on a point, this is very realistic. Not everyone is going to be very conscious that a culture is not a costume, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of us would agree that in this world, we wish that was the case where, you know, you leave these things alone because a culture isn't a costume, isn't, you don't dress up as a stereotype because you're only perpetuating it. But when you enter the workforce, you're going to meet all different types of people. And that's just the reality. Some people who think the complete opposite of you, but like Vincent said, sometimes it's those people who think the complete opposite that you can have the most engaged conversation
mm-hmm.
and grow with. Right? Have some productive dialogue.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the way you approach it. Because if you come at it very harsh, people shut down. If someone came at you really harsh, you shut down. Right? And it could be more than just yes. It could be like, oh, Asian American Day or Chinese New Year and everyone dresses up as like a dragon. You know, it's just, there's these different things. And you'll see a lot of it. And it's just, it's unfortunate. It's very, very unfortunate. And I wish it wasn't like that. But it'd be a disservice to not tell you this. That there are going to be people out there who think differently, who do things that you're just like, oh my God, I would never imagine doing that myself. But that's just the reality of the situation we live in.
And it's in those conversations that you can actually shape and mold the workplace to be a lot more inviting. Because again, like when I started working, I was so used to working in like a resource center, and so used to the college life that when I hit like, you know, working the workforce, it was completely different. Because people were like, they don't have that learned or lived experience that you did, so they don't know. Sometimes they don't know. Like the person I talked to, he literally didn't know. He's like, oh, I didn't know this was an issue. I thought I was okay. So that's something I got again.
Y'all are getting service too. You're good. We have quinoa too, so we'll pass that around.
Thank you.
And also, like, make sure you tell your story. This leads into telling stories. So when you meet people, sometimes it's good to open up with a story. That's how they really get to know you. They're like, I remembered you because you were the one who like fell on the floor when you walked in the door. Stuff like that. And don't embrace embarrassment. Because if you want to, yeah. And I don't want to have to get over to you. If you want to like climb up, you have to be okay with putting yourself out there. And people kind of like, well, not making fun of you, but like you being embarrassed. I tripped my first meeting into the corporate office. I tripped, actually literally tripped into the ground. And like, the CEO was like, are you okay? And I was like, yeah, I think I'm okay. My pride is not, but okay. But embrace embarrassment. And no, it's a good laugh. It's a good story. It's
really healthy.
And no one just to elaborate on
So, be willing to throw yourself out there to those networking events, saying hi, making mistakes is completely fine. We'll all do it. Turn it into a story earlier. And the last one is also be open-minded. Because again, like the whole goal of all these different types of ideas is that you should be open-minded no matter where you're going to work or where you're going to network or whatever program you decide to go to. Because again, the corporate culture, organizational culture is different. You know, like how individuals work is different. So be open-minded when you meet people. And again, like when you hit that one person who's just like threw that big like truck at you with all that information about like their yesterday and stuff, you take it in and then you slowly talk to them about it. You know, have that conversation, engage in that conversation. You don't want to be like confrontational. So always be open-minded, because you never know. Like, they might have experienced something that you didn't know. That's why they're the way they are. Talk about it and then get to learn them. And then, like, they would usually, like, bend a little on that end.
I want to throw in one thing to add on to that, too. Dialogue is very important, but you gauge it.
Mm-hmm.
If that person is being very cold, if it's not a productive situation for you, and you kind of can anticipate that person wouldn't be open and it would just be more damaging to you, then just kind of avoid it if you can. You know, you really gauge it. If you see like some potential where they may be open for dialogue, go for it. But if they're very kind of set in their ways, and I think especially in this new political landscape, right?
Oh, yeah.
In this world we live in now, you really have to, with all these things, it's important to be aware. So you're gauging for your safety. Mental health. I mean, it might not necessarily be your physical safety, but be like for the sake of your mental health, right?
Yeah, that sounds.
You do.
I'm good. That's the sales team. The sales team is very, on our company, the sales team is very rigid. But ever since like certain elections happened, it's been very rough network, to say. And there was an activity, but I don't think we have enough time to do said activity. So I think it's good to end.
You want to end here?
Yeah, because I don't think we have enough time to do that.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Perfect. Everyone, give a round of applause to Vincent. So now we have 15 minutes left. Maybe we can just sit around and have a conversation. Yeah. Dinner and conversation. Any questions you want to ask him?
I did have one. You know how you adjust yourself when you have your culture mindset?
Yeah.
When you're putting up a place where it's